Time's ticking.
Okay, this might take a little while to get.
And we are back between two Yetis. Friday night at the Q Bar. Cinco de Mayo.
Cinco de Mayo.
Cinco de Mayo. With Bert Fowles. How are you?
Zach.
Good to
see
you again.
What's going on?
It's been a year and a bit since we last.
A year and a bit.
Got
you said that eloquently.
Year and a bit. Since then, we've had three hurricanes?
That is correct.
How has that affected your marina business?
Well, the good news, time has moved on.
Yeah.
We had a very resilient team, Zach, that has rallied to the occasion, and our destinations that were impacted. Of our 19 marinas, Zach, we had 9 that were impacted. Don't forget, we also had Jacksonville and St. Petersburg as well up in Florida.
Right.
Yeah. So
33% of your marinas were basically...
Yes, 33% of our marinas were impacted by the storms. That's 33% of our slip inventory.
Right.
So where we are today in May, Cinco de Mayo, mm-hmm. We're coming back strong. We're making a lot of cleanup. Doing a lot of repairs, mm-hmm. and we'll be ready for in big time Q4 season.
What did the hurricane like do to your places? I mean, did the boats obviously smash on the walls and damage the structure, or was it just the infrastructure around them, like the electricity, or?
Well, it's a lot of factors. Everything you said exactly, but the key thing is where are we with structural development, boats. So you had sort of buckets of problems that we had to fix, and they don't get fixed overnight. So one of the key things our teams did was first assess what we really needed, mm-hmm. assess what the island needed, and we also gave away over $200,000 to local, over $200,000 to local charities in 3 specific places right now. St. Martin, we donated in St. Thomas, and we also donated in Turks and Caicos.
Wow.
And we're not done. So we're very happy with the New York Eastern Caribbean front.
Because your marinas kind of are from the Southern Caribbean up through, so the storm kind of follows the path of your marinas, right?
Yes, unfortunately.
So as it goes through it, you're watching CNN, I'm just going, oh, please don't.
We're all watching it very carefully and with an equal sigh. But yes, the key thing is no loss of life.
Absolutely.
And just a wonderful team to come back from it, so I got to give them a shout out.
Absolutely.
Because they really made it happen. But thanks for asking. We're up and running.
It was just amazing because after Herman went, you must guess, and then Maria was just like, oh.
Yeah, we got a double whammy.
Yeah.
We got a double whammy.
And we haven't had one of those for many, many years.
You're totally correct. And it really boils down to having the right insurance, the right details, and everything. But it's good to be coming out of it.
Yeah.
I mean, we've had a hard slog, but we're doing all right.
Now, are boats starting to come back to the Caribbean? Like, because when I was in Antigua last December, they were kind of iffy about staying away because St. Martin was kind of mm-hmm. damaged. Mm-hmm. But now they're all starting to come back this season.
Yeah, good question. First of all, I want to thank all the boats that came out, Zach, right after the storm.
Yeah.
We had a good amount of vessels that I I'm not going to name them, but they just came back.
Yeah.
A lot of them, the owners said, we're going to support the region, and it was just awesome to have them come back.
Absolutely.
To answer your question, the boats are coming back. They're tested. We've got provisioning. We have National Marine, both St. Thomas and St. Martin. Blue Haven's doing the necessary repairs to get Turks and Caicos fully up and running. They are open now. So the good news is all facilities are open, mm-hmm. and we're getting a good influx of vessels that are researching, and I encourage them to do so.
Yeah.
Research it for your charter, research it for your owner, but IGY will be ready for you.
Absolutely. Do you think there was an air of complacency, not from you, but I mean mm-hmm. everyone in general, because we haven't had a hurricane for 10 years,
yeah.
and everyone was just... kind of like it'll be fine. I mean, I was at Home Depot on the day of the hurricane. I mean, I've forgotten something, and there was crowds of people.
Yeah.
And people at Home Depot with megaphones. We've got no wood. We've got no this.
Yeah.
This. And it was just like, have you got any this? And they were like, nah. I was like, okay, I'll go home.
Yeah. I don't think complacency is the right word. I think there was just the reality of what you're dealing with.
Yeah.
Like you said, even we dealt with it here in Florida.
Yeah.
And we're very impacted. You know?
Yeah.
We were quite impacted. So.
But we were ready.
Yeah, well, ready, you know, I like how you put it. Ready is really just being prepared and having mm-hmm. a plan.
Yeah.
As part of an IGY network, you have to have a plan.
Yeah.
You have to follow through it, and you also have to follow through on that plan.
Mm-hmm.
So to answer your question, I think a lot of the islands took it seriously. I think they were trying to prepare as best as possible, but here's a catch-22. How do you prepare, just as you said, when Home Depot uses a bullhorn in the middle of... Florida and you're on an island, those resources, you know, they're limited just based on their inventory.
Absolutely. Yeah. Their location and everything like that. But, so what is there, has anything from this storm changed your business plan or hurricane plan, put it, moving forward? Has it been like, right, we need to make sure we have this, this, and this? Or you think, from what it sounds like, your marinas are pretty much back up and running, so your plan put into action was pretty quick.
Good question. I think from our side, we initiated the plans, and the plans were really solid. I have to say, I always say it's good to have IGY in good times, but it's great to have IGY in bad times. Thank you for that. That was rolled off. I don't know how we, was that good?
That was a plug.
Oh, I like that.
You didn't hear that, did you?
Heck, I like that.
So we cut out the backpack. That was nice.
So what we looked at from that standpoint is really what we've learned is to make sure you have that plan in writing and go through the checklist. And also really understand your communications with the team may be intermittent. You may have to use WhatsApp. You may not have internet. So you're really dealing with sporadic communications and also the center of command. Mm. We've got a great EVP of operations, Kenny Jones, and his military-like direction was invaluable. Mm. Therefore, we didn't have cluttered communication. So if you're looking to get items, he was able to centrally communicate to say, okay, what do you need? Mm. Without getting into the mixed messages of, how are you doing? Everything all right? He knows what's going on, and we were able to implement it. And I think that's probably one of our most valuable lessons, and it's very important because as you and I faced in Florida, any miscommunication like driving north to run out of gas or something like that affects us all.
Absolutely.
You know, you're going to put your family in a car, and you're realizing that's why I have got to hand it to the governor. I mean, his communication was spot on, and in our little case, our little world, we had a good team. We were led well from the top.
That's perfect.
It really is, because it gives the dock hand, the housekeeper, the ability to say, IGY's got my back, I need to do what is important to protect life.
Like I said before, I was watching the news thinking, oh, Bert's going to be busy.
Yeah, well, I tell you, the whole team was busy. And the islands, I have to, you know, the USVI Tourism Board, the BVI's Tourism Board, just really good to communicate. They were at the BVI's were at the recent Miami show.
Yeah.
It just showed good resilience.
Absolutely.
And I think we're going to come back even stronger, but we've just got to work toward it. There is no easy, we have to celebrate every boat.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
What happens if there's, to the industry as a whole, if there's another hurricane this year and another one next year? Because like, we haven't had one for so long. It's kind of like, I feel like now we're getting into a stage where we're going to have more and more. Is that going to really impact the industry enough, or are we going to be, have all the infrastructure there to repair it quickly?
Zach, it's a good question. It really boils down to what type of infrastructure you have. So what you're looking at, are you building solid structures? Are you building docks that you can remove and come back? So,
makes sense.
I think when we're looking at disasters or man-made or whatever, or natural disasters, it really boils down to you got to have the ability to understand that's the cost of doing business. I don't think it'll stop any of the islands, you know, look back in history. Yes, but there will be a different way of looking at your business model, for sure. Is, you know, we deal with short-term seasonal operations in the first place. So
and a boat is basically a business, isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm glad you mentioned that. The recent report by the Marine Industries Association has a vessel spending, 140-foot vessel, Zach, will spend approximately $2 million in maintenance per year.
Wow.
That's $15,000 per foot. That is an economic engine.
And that's a lot of money.
It sure is.
Jesus. And that basically travels with the boat. So if it's in the islands, the marina, or Fort Lauderdale right here.
There you go.
It's amazing.
And also, so what we're looking at, just to give you some industry perspective here in South Florida, 140-foot vessel also generates 41 jobs from one vessel.
Wow.
About 20 direct, so we can say, look, that's a crew member, that's the captain, that's the deckmate, and then the ancillary support or the indirect benefit is the balance of that 41 from the 20.
Jesus.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
It is. Well, and we're part of the industry.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I'm very proud to say, you know, when you look at a big white boat or a big blue boat, you're really looking at, as you said, a little business and jobs.
Jobs, yeah.
And jobs.
I think we talked about this last time. There was a story about, you know, a Hillary supporter sees a big boat and they're like, look how expensive, why do they spend that? And someone, that's 10,000 people's jobs. That fed countless amounts of families.
And the economic impact of that one vessel is $13 million. Wow. Let's go over the numbers one more time. 140-foot vessel, Zach, will support 41 jobs. Exactly.
Yeah.
But well said. 140-foot vessel. But people don't understand. I think we didn't discuss this last time. Our vessels are component parts.
Yeah.
So if you have a Chevrolet and your steering wheel's broken, you go to Chevrolet. Yeah. Your radiator, Chevrolet, and so forth. Our world, we have a vessel that is supported by small companies like Quantum, National Marine, MPT, MHG. So these, if you have an air conditioning problem, you go to an air conditioning specialist.
Yeah.
So what's interesting for our part is, our industry has a large vessel, which people see, and they focus on the vessel or the owner. What they don't see is all the component parts that, you know, support me and you.
Yeah, absolutely. How do we get that message out?
We're doing it right now.
Yes.
Between two Yetis.
Yes, we are.
We are doing it right now between two Yetis. That's what we're doing right now.
But thank you very much for your
always time. Good seeing you.
And we'll see you after the next version.
Yes. Well, let's
we
not go there.
In 10 years.
Yes.
Hopefully in 10 years.
We'll see you that before then. Thanks, Zach.